I have a lot of requests to review various products, but I have a limited amount of time, so I have to be very selective in which ones I choose to evaluate, and only accept ones I expect to perform well. And except for one issue I'll explain later, I was not disappointed with the Pecron E2000. The reason I chose to evaluate this power station is because it sits in a sweet spot of several critical specs. It has a safe battery chemistry with very fast charging capabilities using the included AC charger. It has multiple high power MPPT solar inputs, which I'll put to the test. It has a substantial storage of 1920 kilowatt hours and the option to increase that capacity with additional batteries. It has a 2000 watt inverter, good enough to run most household appliances. With all this capability, it's still small enough to be reasonably portable, especially if you purchase the optional wheeled cart. I've tested this unit with power tools, kitchen appliances, and as a sure power replacement for an RV. Welcome back to Projects with Everyday Dave. Let's run some tests and see if this power station is everything it claims to be. The Pecron E2000 stands out from the crowd when it comes to charging. It has one 12-volt, 100-watt port, 25-volt max input, and two 24-volt to 48-volt, 600-watt inputs. Pecron claims a respectable charge time of 3.5 to 4 hours with the one supplied charger. My test came in right in that range. With a peak input of 555 watts, it took 3.5 hours to reach 100% and 3 hours and 48 minutes to be fully topped off. However, if charge time is super critical, you can purchase a second charger and run them both at the same time. With two chargers, I was able to get a maximum input at power of 1100 watts. I reached 100% charge in 1 hour and 34 minutes and was fully topped off in 2 hours. The unit did get warm during the rapid charge, but not too bad. I could tell by the warm breaker in the load center it was drawing a significant amount of current to charge at that pace. Charging with solar is where the multiple charging ports really comes in handy. Let's start with the Pecron 200 watt folding solar panel. Now, one 200 watt panel is really not sufficient for a power station like this. I put the panel out flat on the ground on a mostly sunny day from 7:45 a.m. till 7 p.m. and only achieved 42% charge. On the second day, I set the panel up on its legs to improve the solar gain. It charged from 7:30 a.m. to 7:30 p.m. and went from 42% to 97%, almost fully charged. Now, if you're not using high drain devices, that might be okay. Otherwise, you really need at least 400 watts of solar input. 2 days in full sun would be a long time to recharge. The Pecron 200 watt portable panel itself is a nice weight and form factor. However, it slightly underperforms relative to other premium solar panels. At 1000 watts per meter squared, it was producing 150 watts, which is 75% of its rated capacity. With other panels, I've been able to reach 80% of rated capacity, which would be 160 watts. With this panel, the max output you can expect to achieve on a perfect day at 1200 watts per meter squared is 180 watts. I tried to use my Blue Eddy 200 watt folding solar panel. However, the voltage wasn't high enough to trigger the MPPT on the high wattage input, and it's too high for the 12 volt input. To show the capability with some higher power panels, I plugged in two Canadian Solar 385 watt bifacial panels, one to each port. I started the charge at 9:25 a.m. from a 0% state of charge. The input ranged from a start of 283 watts to 780 watts at the peak with a solar radiance of about 1104 watts per meter squared. By 2:05, the charge was 100% complete for a respectable charging time of 4 hours and 40 minutes. And that has to be one of my favorite things about this unit. With the three MPPT charge controllers and the two with a very high voltage and power range, this unit can take in a tremendous amount of solar. And if you're running additional battery packs, that extra solar power will really come in handy because you'll have a lot of capacity that needs recharged. All right, I completely charged the unit from solar, and then I used an AC charger to make sure it was completely topped off before I run my capacity test. So I've turned on the DC, and I can tell from my device that it's at 13.3 volts, which means that this is a regulated output. I'm going to pull 100 watts. It's rated for 120 watts, so it'll be really close to its max. All right, at 100 watts, we're at 11.4 volts, which is still okay, a little below 12, pulling 8.8 amps. And on the unit, It's showing 114 watts being pulled. You can also see on the screen, it's predicting how long it expects the battery to last if we continue doing what we're doing now. So at a 115 watt draw, it should last for 16.6 hours. I'd be curious to see if it actually lasts that amount of time. It ran for 17 hours and 18 minutes with a total of 1,722 watt hours out of the rated 1,920 watt hours, which is an impressive 90% of its rated capacity. The adapter port did get pretty warm, but the unit never overheated. All right, let's do an AC load test. I've rewired my water heater to allow me to use alternate power sources, so I just have a plug here wired to it, and we'll be able to take some measurements as we go. Let's power up the AC. Unit is 100% charged, 109.6 volts. It's drawing 1,215 watts, and it predicts it will last 1.4 hours. So far, not even a fan has come on. Let's see what kind of current we're drawing. 11.4 amps. That's exactly what it should be. Voltage has pulled down to 107, 108. It's pretty good. I mean, it's not even breaking a sweat. You would hardly know I had plugged something in. Okay, we have 1200 watt load here, and I thought it would be a good time to check the sine wave output of the unit under a good load. Under a 1200 watt load, getting a reasonably clean sine wave. Little bits of jitter in it, but it looks pretty good. Well, that's a pretty decent load, so let's use that for a capacity test. We'll see how we can do with the AC. 1200 watts continuous until the battery is depleted.
At the supplied 107 volts, it ran for 1 hour and 26 minutes for a total capacity of 1,710 kilowatt hours. Out of the rated 1,920, that gives us 89% of the rated capacity. Surprisingly, only 1% less than the DC capacity. It must have a pretty efficient AC inverter. I tested the maximum battery-only performance for my fridge, which typically draws about 2.3 kilowatt hours per day. I know that's a lot, but the doors on my fridge are open all the time. For this test, the fridge consumed 1.65 kilowatt hours and lasted 17 hours and 47 minutes. That makes it sufficient for overnight emergency use. If I added some solar panels, that would be enough time to get me through the night until the sun came up the next day to recharge the battery, or until I could kick on the generator to recharge the battery.
The miter saw is a great test. It provides a high inductive starting load, and I have an 80 tooth finish blade that I'm using to cut through a 4x4, so it provides a pretty high constant load of 15 to 16 amps. Startup current to just spin the blade up can be over 2400 watts. It's well above the capacity of this power station. In one situation, when I spun the blade up, it did trigger the overcurrent protection and shut down the AC inverter. After that, I tried multiple times spinning up the blade to get it to trip, and it didn't do it again. So it must be very close to the threshold for this unit.
All right, the hot plate is one of the most power-hungry appliances in the kitchen, especially on turbo mode. So let's see if I can boil some water. All right, right off, we're pulling 1,400 watts there, 13.6 amps, maintaining voltage, no problem. And I know it can run for hours at that level, so let's boost it up. Turbo mode, rapid boil. Look at that, that was quick. No problem whatsoever. Let's try the toaster. All right, toaster's a pretty good high power resistive load, and I can turn half on at a time, so let's give it a shot here. 700 and some watts, 7 amps, no problem. Boost it up, 1400 watts. I already know it'll run that continually for hours, so no problem with the toaster. Let's try the microwave. Microwaves require a pure sine wave inverter in order to run properly, so let's see if we can boil a cup of water. Watts is the power rating for the microwave, but as you can see, it draws a lot more than that. We're drawing almost 1500 watts in order to put 1100 watts into the water. So 15 amps holding steady at 108 plus volts and almost exactly 60 hertz. Pretty close to 1500 watts, and I know it'll run that way for a very long time with no problem, so I'm sure we won't have any issue boiling water. 2000 watts is a pretty nice sweet spot. You can run pretty much any appliance in your house and most of your tools, and the battery on this is big enough to actually run things for a while.
Well, it's hot. Microwave works.
All right, I have a piece of hard yellow locust here. I can run through my planer. The planer is the most power-hungry tool that I have. I really don't expect the inverter to be able to run it because oftentimes this will draw upwards of 30 amps, but I'll start low and work my way in and we'll see how far I can get. It takes over 24 amps AC to start up the unit, but it didn't trip out. I start with a pretty light pass and the board is tapered, so the load gets higher and higher as I work my way towards the fat end of the board. The first pass only hits 13 amps, so I start making the depth of cut a little bit deeper each time. With each pass, I get a higher and higher max current, 13 amps, then 15 amps, then 17 amps, then 18 amps, and here we go for the final pass. It starts out at 16 amps, moves its way up, 17, 18, 19, 20 amps, 22 amps, and then, oop, trips out. 22 amps, that's pretty good.
Well, it finally tripped out on us, but man, that was way more than I thought it would do. It was pulling over 2,000 watts, and the inverter's only rated for 2,000 watts, and that is a really heavy load. I didn't think it would run it at all. So, I mean, if you were doing small boards and taking light passes, I think it would work just fine. So that's really impressive. In the tool shop, this thing performs fantastic.
All right, I want to see if the Pecron can be used as a dry dock situation or an emergency backup for a motorhome. So I'm here at my in-laws' motorhome, and we're going to see if we can run the microwave, push the slides out, run the AC, and we'll try a few different things and see what it can do.
30 amp. Typical 30 amp connection. It just reduces it down from 30 amp to 20.
We switched the shore power cord over to 110, so I can plug that directly into the Pecron. Right away, it's drawing 600 or 700 watts for some reason. Why would it be doing that? So let's see, we're pulling 400 watts. Probably, is it charging batteries or something? All right, well, apparently we're pulling several hundred watts.
That's weird.
For something.
I don't know why, there's nothing on.
All right. Well, let's try and run some things. Let's try the AC. That's a pretty high power draw one, right?
Yep.
Ooh, fired up. It's pulling 1100 watts. And blowing cold air. Nice. Now you have two AC units, right?
Correct.
So if you try and run two AC units off 110, it usually doesn't work, right?
Correct.
Well, let's try it, see what happens. No, went up to 4,000 watts.
Why?
Here, I shut it off. All right, so two doesn't work. All right, let's try the microwave. That shouldn't be any issue at all. Let's put it in for 2 minutes. And that is pulling 1,400 watts. So the microwave is probably pulling about 1,000 because there was a base load of about 400 watts.
Right.
Yeah, so if we have 1,400 watts with just the microwave and pretty close to that with just the AC, you can only do one at a time.
Correct.
But the nice thing about it is if you didn't have shore power and you were at a dry dock situation,
right,
you could cook some food or run the AC for a little bit.
Exactly.
That would be really nice.
Yes.
And then the other problem you have is pushing the slides in and out.
Correct.
So if you plugged into shore power somewhere
right,
and you had your slides out,
and that shore power failed for some reason, you can't pull the slides back in.
That's correct.
All right, let's see if it's hot.
Oh yeah, very hot.
All right, so that works. So now that the microwave test is done, let's see if we can operate the slides with the emergency backup.
Okay.
All right, we still have a base load of over 260 watts, and we want to see if we can move the slides. So this... There it goes. And that was no more than 500 watts, so, I mean, it did that no problem.
Right, absolutely.
All right, let's bring the slide in.
It's great, because that's, I mean, you've been stuck before in a situation where you couldn't get the slides in.
Exactly. We had a generator malfunction, and the slides were out. And fortunately, we only had a parking lot to drive with the slides out to find an AC source that we could bring them in. But this would have worked perfect in that situation. We would have just plugged it into this and brought them in, and on, you know, we'd be on our way.
All right, so we've been able to run the microwave, mm-hmm. the slides in and out, the AC. Is that everything? Is there anything else you would need to be able to run?
No, everything else pretty much runs on 12 volt. I will make mention that our RV happens to have two AC units. A lot of RVs only have one. So this would be perfect for them trying to run one at a time. You can always run the front one in the day. You can run the back one at night on a two RV mode, two AC mode. But many motorhomes only have one AC, so it would be perfect.
So I think this would work pretty well as a nice emergency backup for you.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Cool.
Saves a lot of gas, too, on your generator gas. You don't have to run your generator. And some RVs don't even have generators, but most of them do.
Awesome. All right. Thanks.
Yep.
If you use the link in the description and the coupon code provided, for a limited time, you can get 10% off this Pekron E2000 LFP power station. I think from the testing we did, you can see both the capabilities and the limitations of the unit. It's really the max realistic size for true portability, especially if you purchase the accessory cart for wheeling it around to your destination. The 2,000 watt inverter with 1.7 kilowatt hours of battery capacity gives it the capability to power most household tools and appliances for a reasonable amount of time. And the multiple MPPT charge ports gives you lots of options for solar input. If you want to see what it would take to build your own DIY power station, click on this video link. I break down step by step how to build a simple 12 volt 1,000 to 2,000 watt solar generator. I do testing just like in this video and have detailed parts list and cost breakdown that you can download. I have lots of great new projects coming up, so be sure and subscribe, and I'll see you next time.